Good morning, dear students. This is Dr. Savita Tidme, and we are studying the subject Economic Zoology. And we are starting with the chapter number 10, Parasitic Protozoans and Soil Protozoans, from the subject Economic Zoology. And under this chapter, what we are going to study in the present lecture, we are going to study the parasitic protozoans and their role in human welfare, in human health. Right, so number of protozoans you might have seen. So what are the protozoans? Protozoans are basically the unicellular eukaryotic organisms. What they are, you might have seen this amoeba, you might have seen Euglena, paramecium, right? So protozoans, basically a single celled eukaryotic animal. What do you mean by eukaryotic animal? So eukaryotic means bearing true nucleus as well as bearing number of other cell organelles, right? So cell organelles such as the mitochondria, Golgi complex itself, then ribosomes are there. No doubt ribosomes both present in eukaryotic as well as prokaryotic. And along with that, they also bears endoplasmic reticulum, right? So protozoans, they are single-celled eukaryotic organism. They either free living or they either parasitic, which feeds on, if they are free living, that means they are feeding on some existing free living organic matter, right? Such as other microorganisms or organic tissues, some organic debris, if it is there in the environment, that is in the soil or in the water, it also feeds on it. And some debris, kind of a debris, if it is there, it also feed on it. So they are polyphagous, in short we can say. So protozoa are single celled animal that feeds primarily on the bacteria, but if it is not there, it also feeds on other protozoans and soluble organic matter, and sometimes they also feeds on the fungi. So ultimately protozoans, either free living or this especially free living protozoans, they are quite helpful to the human health as well as human environment. They are several times larger than bacteria, ranging from, now if you are saying they are several times larger than bacteria, so what is the range, what is the body size? 5 micron to 500 micron in diameter. So they are quite larger than the bacteria, hence they can feed on the bacteria, right? Ciliate. So as they eat bacteria, protozoa releases excess amount of nitrogen, and that nitrogen, everybody knows that nitrogen is good for the plants. It is helpful for the plant to form their food material, to synthesize their food material, right? So the protozoans, soil protozoans, or you can say free living protozoans, they are useful to human and soil, right? Let's see the protozoans. They are on the basis of their presence in either soil or water or in the body of another animal. So they are categorized into two main categories: free living protozoans and parasitic protozoans. Now, which are the free living protozoans? Amoeba, free living. Yes, you have seen, you might have seen the amoebas in the water. Euglena, also free living. Paramecium is also free living protozoa, right? And now, what are the parasitic protozoans? Which are they? So parasitic means what? These protozoans, they depend on other animal for fulfilling their requirement. They used to live inside the body of other animals, right? So hence they are said to be parasitic. But as this is not only enough that they are living inside the body of other animal, hence they are parasitic. Because as they are living into the body or inside the body of other animals, exploiting them as well as causing some diseases in the animal or host, hence they are parasitic, right? So such as Entamoeba histolytica is again a parasitic protozoan. Gardias, this Gardias is again long worm, it is like a threadworm. Yes, it is called as a threadworm. It measures from 2 mm to 2 meters of the size and observed in most of the vertebrates. Balanteria blastocystis hominis, or it is also called as Blastocystis vagina. Some parasites are there, like Trichomonas vaginalis exist inside the vagina, or some causes systematic infection. Some parasites, they causes systematic infection, right? Such as Plasmodium falciparum is one of the parasitic protozoan that infect a human being and causes what? Malaria disease in human. So some free living protozoans are there. Along with them, some parasitic protozoans are also there. What we are going to do, we are going to see the role of those parasitic protozoans, few of them, in human welfare. Okay, all right. So let's take a first example, Entamoeba histolytica. So Entamoeba histolytica, it is found inside the gut in certain cases, quadrinucleated cyst is been ingested by the human along with some infected water or food stuff. So it get excised and then it reside into the intestine, where it proliferates, attains the shape of this trophozoid, and then it proliferate, it feeds on the tissues, as well as it causes bleeding, that is rupturing, damage of the intestinal wall. So this Entamoeba histolytica, it exists in three main stages: trophozoite stage, precystic stage, and cystic stage. Now this trophozoite is this stage, is actually the feeding stage, right? When this Entamoeba histolytica, or you can say cyst, is entered inside the body, it get excised, right? And it attains a form of this trophozoid. So from a single cyst, near about 8 amoebae that releases. Some of them are virulent, some of them are non-virulent. So those are virulent, they further forms a trophozoid, and then this is going to feed on the intestinal tissues. It enters into intestinal tissues and infect them, right? So this is what the trophozoite in precystic stage. Trophozoite, as it is a feeding stage, is keep on multiplying, and after that what happened? After some cycles, few cycles, person may show symptoms, person may not show symptoms of a diarrhea. So a symptomatic stage can be called. So this cyst to trophozoite, some of them forms a trophozoite, some of them forms a cyst. So this is a precystic stage where a single nucleus is there. Okay, so precystic stage is there, single nucleus bearing. From the precystic, binucleated, then quadrinucleated cysts are there, right? So binucleated, it is again a cystic stage, right? Where this chromatin bodies are there. Chromatin bodies are just a color forming bodies are there. It has no relation with the genetic material. And then quadrinucleated cyst, that is actually the infective stage. So in the feces of such a person who is infected with this Entamoeba histolytica, may be all the four stages may be observed, that is trophozoite, mononucleated cyst, binucleated, and quadrinucleated cyst also seen, or it can be seen in the feces or fecal matter of such a person. Now, what pathogeny does it cause? Okay, what pathogenicity does it cause? Right, it causes diarrhea, dysentery, hepatitis, even the liver abscess. If the cyst is migrated towards the liver, where it starts proliferation, right? So liver abscess may be caused. Dysentery is there because of the release of the toxins, as well as rupture of the walls, and the person is become excessively anemic, blood loss is there, right? So Entamoeba histolytica does affect the human health. It has an adverse effect on the human health and human life. Now the next protozoan parasite is Plasmodium falciparum. Everybody knows that Plasmodium falciparum is a protozoan parasite that causes the disease malaria. And this Plasmodium falciparum, it exists in number of different variants, or you can say number of different forms. Like Plasmodium ovale is there, Plasmodium malariae is there, right? So this Plasmodium falciparum, basically here is the life cycle I have given. So this Plasmodium falciparum. It is transmitted through the female Anopheles mosquito. It is in the form of a sporozoite. If the sporozoite, which is present in the saliva of such a female, and the female when suck or bite human, inject her proboscis, along with that she used to release some saliva, and along with the saliva these parasite, that is sporozoite stage, is entered in the human blood, from where it get migrated to liver. Inside the liver tissues it further multiplies, rupture the liver cell, again invade the liver cells and forms a schizont. From sporozoite it forms a schizont. Okay, all right, we don't need to go into the life cycle in very detail because this is quite a big topic, so we'll just go through the pathogenicity. Okay, so this Plasmodium falciparum, as it used to feed on the, or it used to damage the liver cells, right? After the pre-erythrocytic, this stage is called as a pre-erythrocytic stage. It releases a macrogametocyte, or you can say a macromerocyte. Yes, macromerozoite, that going to invade the erythrocyte, and it passes through a successive erythrocytic stages. So that is called as asexual stage passed in the blood, or erythrocytic stage of Plasmodium vivax or falciparum, right? So after successful erythrocytic stage, it forms a macro and micro gametocyte, and this macro and micro gametocyte keep waiting to enter into the body of their invertebrate host, that is a female Anopheles mosquito. Meanwhile, what happened? It used to infect the blood cells, causes rupturing of the blood cells, right? So ultimately the person is having, or a person shows successive stages of high temperature, low temperature, high temperature, low temperature, immunity is again dropped down, such a person is become anemic, we can say, right? So this Plasmodium falciparum causes malaria. Nowadays there is, again we can say, science has now progressed a lot, and we have medicine to fight against such a Plasmodium vivax, and we can protect ourselves. But the best thing is to avoid entry of such a invertebrate in our houses, right? So Plasmodium is one of the parasitic protozoan. Let's see who is next. Yes, Trypanosoma brucei is again one of the parasitic protozoan. Okay, Trypanosoma brucei. So here is, I have shown a life cycle of Trypanosoma brucei. Now it involved again two hosts. So it is a diagenic parasite. The primary host is actually the human. Vertebrate host is sometimes, or in some references, it is treated as a primary host. Invertebrate is treated as a secondary host. And another one method of classification is that the sexual stage is passed in which host, that host is said to be the vertebrate host. Okay, so here is the life cycle of the Trypanosoma brucei. One phase is passed in the body of a human, and another phase is passed in the body of a invertebrate insect, that is tsetse fly. So whenever the tsetse fly bite human, right, so the specific stage of this parasite entered into the body of human, where it undergoes further multiplication, it attack on the macrophages, where it multiply further, again increases in number, and whenever such a tsetse fly is going to feed on the human blood, once again this parasite short stumpy stage is again entered into this one, that is invertebrate host, where it again multiplies further. So life cycle is very simple. But my dear students, do you have any idea the small single celled protozoan parasite, what it does? It causes a disease called as sleeping sickness, right? It cause a disease called as a sleeping sickness in human, right? So this sleeping sickness is quite deadly. In previous few days, when there were no medicines available for such a sleeping sickness disease, it is also called as a trypanosomiasis. But nowadays number of such a medicines, anti-protozoal medicines are there, anti-parasitic medicines are there, which can, with the help of that, one can get rid of this trypanosoma parasite from the body. How you will identify this parasite in the blood or in the body? This is again extracellular stage. It is freely exist in the bloodstream, so it get migrated towards the any organ, like in the liver, lungs, intestine, kidney, brain, everywhere it can get migrated, right? So this parasite can be easily investigated with the help of a blood smear. It appears like this into the blood smear in between the blood cells. So it causes a disease, sleeping sickness in human. So this fly, though if human host is not available for this fly, then what happened? How the parasite is get means how it can be exist, because the life stage life of this say fly is quite limited, no? Okay, then my dear students, this parasite not only exists in human, no, it is not only going to infect the human, but whenever this say fly, if it is feeding on the other vertebrate host, wild vertebrate host, like maybe buffaloes, wild buffaloes, maybe dog, maybe any canine or antelope, if it is there, means any kind of a wild animal, if it is there, it also feed on on such a wild animals and get the blood meal. Now, along with the blood meal, it releases stages. It releases this parasite into the body of that vertebrate host, like antelope or any other canine, right? And that canine, if it, as it is a wild in habit, it doesn't suffer from any kind of such a diseases, but it act as a reservoir host, and reservoir host is the host which is having a capacity to continuously generate this parasite from their body, right? So these parasites keep on multiplying in the body of such a reservoir host, and whenever a new or fresh say fly is going to feed on the blood of such a reservoir host, she will get parasite in its body, and when she is going to feed on it human blood, she going to transmit the parasite into the human. So this Trypanosoma brucei was one time in Africa was a serious problem. Because of that, number of people were died in African countries because of this trypanosomiasis. All right, let's move ahead. Okay, Leishmania, again one of the, or you can say one more parasitic protozoan. See, you can see a small sized protozoan, but that causes a number of diseases, number of problems in human being, right? So this Leishmania actually it exists in two forms, right? Omastigote and promastigote form. This is called as a promastigote, which is bearing a long flagella, right? And this one is omastigote form. Let's see. So this Leishmania causes a disease, leishmaniasis. What it cause? It causes a disease, leishmaniasis, or it is also called as Kala-Azar. See, Leishmania is again exist in number of different variants. Its strains are there. So Kala-Azar, cutaneous leishmaniasis is there, visceral leishmaniasis is there, right? So, okay. So this Leishmania is transmitted, or the parasite, protozoan parasite, is been transmitted by the fly, sand fly. What is the name of the fly? Sand fly, that going to transmit this parasite. All right, so this parasite, when the sand fly, again the same way, when sucks the blood of a human, right, and she receives the epimastigote, right, epimastigote or flagellate stage, because it is exist inside the macrophages. So this epimastigote stage is there, and this epimastigote is again further proliferate in the midgut of this sand fly and becomes a procyclic promastigote stages, bearing a tail, or you can say a flagella. Further, it again proliferate to metacystic promastigote, which is again ready to infect a human. When such a fly, that is a sand fly, bearing this metacyclic promastigote in its blood or in its saliva, so it used to transmit the same along with the saliva into the human bloodstream. So this metacystic cystic promastigote. So this is the promastigote kind of, right? So this promastigote along with the flagella, it used to fly, it used to swim into the bloodstream and find out the macrophages or the blood cells and again invert them and loses their flagella and becomes an intracellular mastigote stage. So this is intracellular mastigote stage. Now, then this again multiply inside the macrophages and releases in the more number of a promastigote, epimastigote, again which invade the fresh macrophages and again continue multiplying. So this cycle inside the blood of human is going to continue, whereas some of the mastigote stages, they passed into the body of sandfly if they get a chance, right? Now if this increases into the human blood, then what happened? As this parasite is present in the human blood, so human body is also going to show some kind of a reaction, some kind of a resistance for this parasite, right? As well as this parasite is also going to protect himself against the human immune system, right? So it releases some kind of a antitoxins, or it kind of a toxins, it releases a kind of a toxins against the host immune system, and host immune system is going to release antitoxins so as to neutralize it. So such a kind of immune fighting is going on inside the human body. Even these macrophages mastigote forms also invade, depend now if it is a visceral leishmania or it is a cutaneous leishmania. So if it is a visceral leishmaniasis, it going to infect the liver, spleen, then even lungs too. And this visceral leishmaniasis causes enlargement or fatigue of the spleen as well as a fatigue or enlargement of the kidney, right? Because these two organs, they become more active so as to get rid of this parasite. So they used to produce more amount of the, you can say, defensive cells or hemopoietic cells, so as to get rid of this parasite, right? In case of a cutaneous leishmaniasis, these parasites, they are going to release some kind of, as I said earlier, these parasites going to release toxicant, right? And so as to neutralize the toxicant, as in just a defensive mechanism, so as to protect themselves, so as to neutralize those, that toxicant, our body is going to produce antitoxins. So in case of a cutaneous leishmaniasis, because of the toxicant produced by this mastigote forms, the color of the body, color of the skin of a person is changes towards the black. So high temperature is there again, even immune system of the person is dropped down, person become more anemic, right? These are some symptoms of the Kala-Azar or leishmaniasis, okay? So immunity is dropped down as these macrophages are being infected. Macrophages are nothing but the immune cells or defensive mechanism of the body, but they are now getting infected, and so immune system is dropped down, even the anemia is there, right? And the color of the body turns black as our body is continuously producing the macrophages, or you can say defensive cells, hemopoietic cells, they are continuously producing. So body's temperature is going to be maintained high because of the antibody reaction, you can say toxicant and detoxicant reaction. Body's again mechanism is going to be, or metabolism is going to be slightly high. So these leishmaniasis in previous years, means in the few years back, was responsible for several deaths in many countries, but now science has advanced and so many medicines are available so as to treat this leishmaniasis, or so as to treat the visceral leishmaniasis as well as cutaneous leishmaniasis. But parasitic protozoans, they are quite dangerous member and causes a tremendous health hazard in case of a human, right? Now let's take a small point, that is parasitic protozoan and the scope of the public health impact, how they causes effect on human health, that we have already studied. But let's see a study report from one of the research paper. I have taken it. So diarrhea अगेन इट इज कॉज्ड बाय हु? इट इज कॉज्ड बाय द एंटामीबा हिस्टोलाइटिका. सो इट इज करंटली द सेकेंड लीडिंग डेथ कॉज ऑफ डेथ इन चिल्ड्रन यंगर देन 5 years ऑफ द एज एंड इज एसोसिएटेड विद अराउंड 5 lakh डेथ पर ईयर. दिस इज नॉट रिसेंट रिपोर्ट, दिस वॉज फ्यू ईयर्स बैक रिपोर्ट, राइट? सो ऑल दो डायरिया कैन बी कॉज्ड बाय मेनी पैथोजेंस इन अ लार्ज पोर्शन ऑफ केसेस द कैजुअल ऑर्गेनिज्म इज अ पैरासाइटिक प्रोटोजोन. नो डाउट डायरिया कैन बी कॉज्ड बाय एनी काइंड ऑफ अ पैथोजन, बट द मोस्ट प्रोबेबल इट इज कॉज्ड बाय द पैरासाइटिक प्रोटोजोन, राइट? सो इन 2010, नाउ हियर इज द ईयर मेंशन, इन 2010 द एस्टिमेटेड 357 मिलियन केसेस ऑफ द इलनेसेस विथ एट लीस्ट वन ऑफ द थ्री एंटेरिक प्रोटोजोन, वन ऑफ द थ्री केसेस, वन केस आउट ऑफ थ्री, राइट? सो 3057 मिलियन केसेस वेर रिपोर्टेड इन 2010, आउट ऑफ विच इफ थ्री केसेस वेर कंसिडर्ड, वन केस आउट ऑफ थ्री वॉज बिकॉज ऑफ द एंटेरिक प्रोटोजोन, बिकॉज ऑफ द एंडोपैरासाइटिक प्रोटोजोन, और वी कैन से बिकॉज ऑफ द पैरासाइटिक प्रोटोजोन लाइक अमीबा, क्रिप्टोस्पोरिडियम, गार्डिया, राइट? रिजल्टेड इन 33,900 deaths in 2010. So, in a recent study of the moderate to severe diarrhea in Africa and Asian children, so Cryptosporidium species were some of the top diarrhea-associated pathogens, right? So, the parasitic pathogens, they does influence the human health, they does affect the human health and human life, and in some cases, if not treated or if not paid attention, these parasitic protozoans, they are responsible for causing death in human also.